3D printing is really cool because you can make little objects like this. This little GoPro mount. It's pretty cool. But if you get really serious about it, you can design a cylinder head that's worthy of the most powerful letter in the world. M. This is the brand new S58M engine, and it will be the unit powering the new G80, G82, M3, M4, but for now, it is available under the hood of this. It is the 2020 BMW X3 and X4 M. BMW is now kind of copying AMG because they give you different levels of their M models. So now you can get the base, which is hilarious, you can call it base, X3M and X4M, which has 473 horsepower, or you can have the X3 X4M competition with 503. They might have different horsepower numbers, but the torque is the same, 442 pound-feet. However, the delivery range is a little bit different. The S58 3-liter inline six-cylinder is definitely the highlight here, you know, being the new M engine and all. It has a new stronger block, a cylinder head that could only be produced using additive 3D printing because of the complex design. It's also more lightweight. It has a very efficient intake system, two monoscroll turbochargers blowing air in three cylinders each, super fast acting electronic wastegates for really good throttle response, motorsport inspired oil management and feeding so the engine is never starved, and very clever intercoolers. With launch control in place and a blazing quick 8-speed automatic transmission, 0 to 100 kilometers an hour comes in 4.1 seconds or 4.2 as we tested it, and the car will keep going strong till about 285 kilometers an hour. Roll-on power is also killer. Any input on the throttle pedal is immediately translated in a really good thrust of torque, and that red needle really starts climbing up like it just took a whole box of Viagra. Performance is unquestionably breathtaking, but despite having an exhaust button and a second level flap that only opens in Sport Plus, the car just never gets as loud as I'd like it to be. You can put it in efficient mode and then shut the exhaust up and make it really, really quiet. However, to be real, I really don't know why you do that. I really wish it was 20% louder. I hope you, Remus and Akrapovic, are listening because this is an opportunity. Another really good thing about having such an optimized and well-engineered engine, especially in 2019 where everybody's so anal about emissions, is that this motor and this drivetrain in general is actually pretty fuel efficient. I've been averaging about 14 liters per 100 kilometers in these freezing temperatures, and to be honest with you, for what this is, that's actually amazing. You don't need a Prius to save the world. Buy one of these. Being an M version also means better suspension and brakes. The ride quality definitely pays the price for this ultra stiff suspension setup, which is performance oriented, obviously. But because the whole thing is, you know, always in a racy mood, I kind of forgive shaking me up a little bit. I mean, yeah, it's hard, but do I mind? No. Potholes might be really annoying, but once you start turning this thing, you will totally forgive it for giving you some bruises on your back. The seats, however, are really comfortable and support the body extremely well, and they kind of hug you like your mama. When you start turning, believe it or not, there's almost no body roll, no pitch, no nothing. Just sharp turn in and flat cornering. Yes, the center of gravity is higher up, it won't turn as well as an M3, but it's not far behind. For older people or people that have back problems that can't get into like a low car, the value of the trade-off here is unbelievably good. We took an X4M on the track, which is pretty much the same thing as this, and let me tell you, the steering is very well weighted and feels really quick and precise, helping the driver point to his entry and the car follows the input to the T. Mid-corner stability is exceptional, with understeer tensions that can be transitioned to power oversteer on exit. This thing is not only quick on a track, it's also dead easy to drive. And the brakes, oh my god, they have all the stopping power you need, lap after lap, no fade. What's truly amazing is after all this blah blah, you step back and you understand that we're talking about an SUV or SAV or SAC as BMW calls them. It's truly incredible that these cars can actually do all that. And it looks really hot, especially with these M Sport bumpers and black Shadowline grills and this color, the Donington Gray Metallic, is just perfect. The 20-inch wheels are very good looking and show off those high-performance brakes. At the rear, we have a spoiler on the top and really nice exhaust on the bottom, and overall this thing looks really good. Inside, it's all familiar X3, only you get more leather-wrapped surfaces, sport stitching everywhere, very cool M seats that have illuminated M badges, and a steering wheel with two red buttons on it. Quality-wise, it's way above your average Joe. It might not be as good as a GLC, but the design is much nicer, and ergonomically, it wins hands down. You get a very handy wireless charger, wireless Apple CarPlay, absolutely no Android Auto at all, a very nice and clear instrument cluster, a customizable heads-up display, and a gear selector from hell, but it does have two really cool buttons on the top, which you can adjust how much you want it to hold onto the revs. It's not how fast it shifts, it's how long it takes to do so. You can adjust everything on this car, including the throttle response, suspension stiffness, steering effort, gear shift timing, and the stability control level. Best of all, you can cook up two recipes and save them as M1 and M2, and then recall them anytime you like, using the two red buttons that mean business. Roominess inside is also great for a family. Their rear seats are also heated and offer good legroom and headroom. With a nice panoramic sunroof, the interior feels very happy and bright, and the trunk is big enough for everyone's luggage for a weekend getaway. I do understand all the gearheads that say that, come on, SUVs can't be sporty because they're heavy and the only thing they'll be doing is racing for a parking spot in the parking lot. But to be honest with you, we need to accept that these cars now work. People buy them because they work. So yes, they don't compare to a lightweight sports car with a manual transmission and a rear-wheel drive with a limited slip differential, but you know what? In the real life, again, they work and people buy them. Accept it, they're good. The X3M non-competition starts at $82,700 Canadian. And quite frankly, if you get one of those, you can just tune it and make much more power than the competition one does. But if you want a competition, the X3M competition starts at $93,000. As tested here, it's $99,000, and the X4 equivalent models are just about $1,600 extra. Between this, the GLC 63S AMG, the Alfa Romeo Stelvio Quadrifoglio, Porsche Macan Turbo, and the Jaguar F-Pace SVR, I don't know, I'd be torn between this and the Macan, but if you'd like to have one of these, you better go check it out. Overall score for this X3M competition, 9 out of 10. Before I end this, I'd like to thank everybody for watching. Please remember to subscribe, share with your friends, press like if you like the video, leave us a comment, tell us what you want us to review next. Till next time, be well.
So I'm gonna kind of go through the entirety of the track. So now you're gonna start bending it in right at that cone to the inside. All the way out wide, off the gas, start squeezing the brake. Wait for my cue, 3, 2, 1, now bend it in. Nice smooth input, get the nose pointed before you squeeze, very good. And keep it nice and tight on the inside. Good, once your point is, give it a little bit of throttle. Right tire is basically on the paint here. Off the gas and squeeze the brakes here. And you're holding that middle line here until you get to near the flag stage, you get back over to the inside, right close to the apex, and right before the apex, you'll squeeze the throttle, you're gonna arc it back over to the left. And off the gas, straighten out your hands a little bit on the brakes. You're gonna go just past the center seam here. You get the nose in, get the nose in, get the nose in. Now squeeze out wide, very good. Mm-hmm. Off throttle on the brakes. I'm gonna try to get on this curb in here. A little bit too much speed there, a little bit less speed next time. Bend it in. Out wide, good. Keep it nice and tight through there. Straight out wide, nice. Now we're gonna be coming up to a little chicane here, so just a little bit of brakes. And remember, smooth, minimal input here. A little bit there, to the right, and start scrolling the throttle, nice. All the way to the left as we're coming up to the bus stop on the right. So off throttle on the brakes, a little bit more, a little bit more, a little more brake. Back to the inside, and squeeze the throttle wide, nice. Late turn in 3, 2, 1, now bend it in. I want to stay all the way on the right side. Not too much throttle here because we're coming up the switchback. This is a tight, tight section. Tight, tight until you're pointed and roll the throttle. Very good. 3, 2, 1, bend it in. Tight on the inside, out wide and off the throttle. A little bit of brake here. Right tires on the paint and then back to the inside and then left tires on the paint.
I told you we're going to catch a Supra.
Yeah, I don't know if it's a Supra's fault though. It may be that Lexus's fault.
That's obviously the Lexus fault. Perfect.